Hi, this is Anthony, recovery coach with Scott Kidd. We're talking about now, this is part two of why people drink drug and the apparent benefits or the benefits they actually, why they're doing it. And now, what are the benefits of recovery? So we're going to compare and contrast these, but now we're going to go on what we call part two of the talk, which is like, for me, why I continue to be a straight edge. I've been a total straight edge 16 years. I've been off drugs for 40. I drank very socially, meaning, very mildly for about, 15, 16 years or so, maybe more, maybe 20. Actually, it was more than like, it was probably about 20 years after I quit other drugs and pharma. What's the benefit for me in being a straight edge? And what we alluded to in the first talk was why people were using was to get to a particular mood or attitude or feeling or state of mind, state of being, interactions with others. I have similar, motivations. I have the benefits of being with other individuals, the positive benefits of the attitudes I have, the moods I'm able to create, even in my best and worst times. I prefer straight edge over all of it. I mean, I don't even have a craving for alcohol. Actually, when I quit alcohol 16 years ago, totally, I had zero cravings. I didn't think, when I say cravings, I mean mental too.
Yeah.
I didn't even, oh my God, it would be great to be drinking, emotional. It would be great to feel that way. Physical, it'd be great to get that buzz on again. Zero of it, right? And perhaps we'll get into a little bit of that on this little chit chat. We got about a little less than half an hour. For you, why is drinking or drugging again, like, so far from your kin, so far from your, belief system that you'd be like, are you kidding? Be like, be like, hey, we're going to, how's that hammer bashing on the thumb today? Well, I was really looking forward to the next bash. Right. And it's like, no, which is, I got to tell you this brief story. I'm talking a lot, but I got to tell you the story before I forget it. There was a study done. I mean, these fucking psychologists are always coming up with some dumbass fucking study, but it was really valuable. Okay, so you get no stimuli, okay? No one to talk to, no phone, nothing to do for like half an hour. You get two choices, nothing, or you can self-shock yourself by touching a button. Okay, those are the two options for half an hour. Okay, so there's no stimuli, there's nothing to do, no talking, no, just being there, right? There were individuals who self-shocked in excess of 20 times, and some even greater than that. Almost 40 or 50% self-shocked, 40 to 50% self-shocked one or two times instead of just being with themselves, right? And I went, I mean, fucking stupid study and brilliant study at the same time. I mean, it really goes to show, I mean, what the art of recovery, in my belief, this is for me. Again, these opinions are my opinions and Scott's opinions, but in my assessment, the skill of recovery has been the skill and the ability to be with myself. To be myself, to just be present, right? That has been, if I summarize the entire skill, that I would call it that. And I've been getting better and better and better and better at it and getting to the point where I could be in very uncomfortable situations, very, and still be with myself without having to escape or shock myself. So I laugh because I go, who would do that? Well, apparently 50%. Of the participants. Now, I don't know if they skewed to the crazy, but I think these were just regular people, So anyway, you can call if you want to comment on that or not, or just talk right about like why, you know, what's your thing for like why do you stay a straight edge? I mean, why bother? I mean, what's the benefit for you, Scott?
I drink coffee, right? So, and I like sugar, so I don't know how straight edge I really am, but
Okay.
I'll bust myself on that first.
Okay, fair enough.
And the other part, just to, you know, without knowing too much about the study, but from what you describe, it'd be interesting to know, like, you know, on a molecular level, how the pain response to that st to those stim electric stimuli might have resulted in increased transmission of endogenous opiates and neurotransmission, right? So who knows?
Exactly.
There's a fine line between pleasure and pain, as they say, right?
And this
Whoever
proved
they
it.
are.
And this proved it
But I think
50% of the time.
I don't know. I think it's a true for me because, like, I can get just as addicted to painful situations as I can to other situations. Sometimes drama and pain and suffering was a place that I like to be in.
Now,
It validated my, but this is talking more about the benefits of
the addiction,
yeah, but really, if you think about it too, though, that's also the benefit of like not using, right? Is that, you know, I get a chance to, you know, as you said, feel comfortable in my own skin.
and also feel the experience. It's like, you know,
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, like you feel the pain. Life is painful.
There's a certain joy, and this is not a nihilistic or in any way sadistic at all, but there's a certain pleasurable experience in feeling incredibly embarrassed, you know, in a social situation, or terrified. You know, like why do people go on roller coasters, for example? There's a certain exhilaration of just experience and being present with the experience and just going, you know, I mean,
Oh
I gotta, yeah.
I'm starting to like use dopamine in a more regular kind of observational experience way.
Yeah.
Right? So all I know is that, yeah, the benefits of like natural neurotransmission are far exceed the benefits of like false transmission because like, yeah, there's, yeah. Beyond that's beyond what I need to like opine on right now.
Yeah. Okay.
But I mean the benefits of recovery are literally that, you know, it's like gives me a chance to well, realign with who I really am, my authentic self. Right, like it gets me to a place of like being able to recognize again, be aware of what I value in my life.
Yeah, what are some of those values?
For me, well, it's their community, their health, their family, relationships in general. Those are just a few.
Yeah.
Knowledge.
Yeah, I'm a knowledge addict. I mean, actually, I'm gonna take that back because I do not want to use the word addict incorrectly. I love knowledge, right? I love or information because knowledge is quite different than information. I've discovered that knowledge is a certainty of information or certainty of action or behavior, which actually is closer to faith than data. You know, well, nine times out of 10, you know, people who take chances succeed more than those who don't. Great. Just an example, right? So now, being certain about that is quite different than knowing it on an analytical level and going, oh yeah, I believe that, but not going, okay, and therefore taking the chance, you know, pretty much every time, right?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, just, you know, that's the other benefit of recovery too, is that, you know, I get a chance to go into open-mindedly. Be curious about what different aspects of reality actually are, right? So that's what I'm saying is that, you know, my world of in the past was delusional, to say the least, right? So there's a big difference between what's actually real and what I believe to be true or certain about. And all the stuff that I, you know, my brain got damaged enough by drugs and alcohol, you know, my ability to really cognitively understand what reality was handicapped, to say the least. That's one of the benefits too, right? Is that I'm able to actually like not just stay stuck in my attitudes and beliefs, and I'm actually capable. I'm not saying I do it all the time, but I'm more capable of appreciating how I relate to other people, and how I relate to other people is by being, you know, curious and open-minded and validating of what their experience of reality is. And from that, I can maybe, if I'm willing, then I can learn a bit more about myself and how my attitudes have changed in terms of what I truly believe, you know, or what I truly am addicted to. If I'm addicted to family, or addicted to my health or whatever, right? However that might look to these values that get reestablished and anchored by my experience, open-eyed experience and awareness of where I am in the world in relation to the world. Like all I'm saying is it got pretty closed-minded and closed and isolated and siloed at, you know, at the end, you know, it's like basically just, you know, you get to a place of aloneness, right? And you're not relating. So the ultimate benefit for me is that I can relate to other people today in a way which is profoundly different than what it was like before. And I can relate to myself today in a way that was profoundly different than it was like before. And I can approach it with, you know, like this Richard Rohr idea, I can approach it with not just black and white thinking. I can approach it with gray thinking today, which is a way different way of opening the door to having healthy, positive relationships. And I think that's just what it is. So relationship with myself and relationship with others and the world, right? Because I don't know if there's anything else actually at the end of the day in life, right? My rigid belief systems that I developed in the dark of addiction, you know, really impacted how other people wanted to relate with me. And then they, because of that, you know, the guilt and shame impacted how I felt about myself and how I looked at myself. Today, it's like more like, you know, whatever floats your boat, man. Like, you've got choices too. It's you know, like, thank God I got choices today. So I was pretty rigidly, firmly without choices when I was like at the end.
Isn't that beautiful? Yeah, so recovery for you has not only allowed you to be your authentic self, but to be authentically with others so they can be themselves, and both you and them and your whole social dynamics could grow in a positive way. You could learn new things and experience aspects of yourself which you were shut off to, being in this rigid condition of got a drink, got a drug. There are people in my building who are literally out every hour to hour and a half so that they can toke up, you know? And I'm going, oh yeah. My gosh, you know, it's like, I mean, talk about a trap, you know?
All the time that was spent in the behavior is now directed towards other more healthy behaviors for sure. My health is better, 100% it's better. My And that's, and I could confirm that with blood tests and stuff. But I don't need to. My mental health is better, like I said, a lot of that. So there's like this emotional, like physiological and spiritual components that are all kind of coming back still. And there's lots of work to keep doing on that, but that's part of the fun. You see, like, it's not about the end game or outcome anymore. It's about like, well, let's just keep going and see and have fun while we're on the ride. But the ride is just a different kind of ride. It doesn't have like this need for certainty or I don't know, or arrogance, like it's about like being right about every fucking thing.
Yeah.
You know, I'm happy being wrong today. Let's put it that way.
Isn't
very
it great?
Very very happy being wrong. And my family's happy that I feel that way. And my friends are happy that I feel that way. Like, you know, so it's really interesting, right? This discussion is interesting because it really is like, what is the ultimate benefit of recovery? And I think I could nail it really quickly. Like, they call it vital spiritual experience in 12-step facilitation, right? But I call it just awareness. Of self and others. Maybe that's just it. Maybe that's the boil it down to that crap. You know, I don't know. Maybe. But you see, that's the thing. I'm okay with that just being a maybe today instead of like, that's what it is.
That's beautiful. Yeah, so life actually becomes simpler in recovery. And in that simplicity, there's so much more. I mean, it's wild. You know, we get the simpler and the boundaries that become less and less and less. It's phenomenal what occurs. And that statement you said, which was really quite funny, I was smiling and I thought, there's not, why do I like Scott? And, you know, like, it's like, you know, when these back, you know, like they sort of sitting in the back, they're like, you know, question, I don't actually activate it continuously. It was just thought, well, why do I like him? And it's like what you said about I like being wrong, and others like, you know, that I like being wrong, and I like to find out where I'm wrong. And it's like I have been saying that about myself for probably 30 years. It is, and it's like, and you know, like, why would you do that? Well, I'm unfixing. You know, I'm not, I'm getting more, I'm more in the flow. I'm more, you know, I'm actually more willing to be others and be with others and allow them to be who they are and experience really new things as opposed to, you know, experience things as you fix the being, right? Oh, it's been awesome,
yeah.
You know?
Totally, right? Like, I mean, like, when, like, it's like, there's a something around that of like, you know, being like what comes up for me is like something about being naked or being innocent again, right? And like to be having that sort of innocent curiosity about how things are going to go and like not having to be so firmly entrenched in the idea it has to be a certain way and there has to be a certain outcome, right? Because all that does is like create fear and rips me out of like the ability to be aware or present of where I am in the moment, right? I'm futurizing or I'm in the past. In the future, I'm going to be super freaking fearful and anxious. And if I'm in the past, I'm going to be super fearful and depressed. It's just what it is. So recovery, in a way, gives me a chance to find some balance in perspective of where I'm at today and awareness of that so that I can actually, like be a useful, positively contributing member of society today.
Isn't
and
it?
not be a burden anymore. That is a benefit for other people for my recovery. But it gives me a good feeling because in doing esteemable acts, I gained self-esteem. And I lost my self-esteem because I was not in alignment with the values around the esteemable acts that I was not doing when I was wasted. I know, nothing very esteemable about like some of the things I did.
Isn't it beautiful to actually discover that? Is that with the biggest reason I spent about 10, 15 years on the phones as a consultant, and I had, you know, families calling me and individuals calling me, I got to get into rehab, etc. Life is a disaster. And the main families and individuals in various levels of addiction, alcoholism, drug dependency had 70-80%. Now, this is 20,000 people, okay? 70-80% of those individuals mentioned as number one or one of the main reasons, actually it was more like 100% if it was one of them, of the reasons that they were using or alcoholic and that they wanted to regain or that they were lacking. And that thing that they wanted to regain or was lacking was self-esteem. He's lacking, she's lacking self-esteem. It was to a degree, 100%. And then, but the number one or number two reason, 70, maybe 80% of the individuals, they are lacking self-esteem or they want greater self-esteem. You know, it was like this from mom, right? Oh, and self-esteem is in the toilet. You know, oh, her self-esteem, you know, like she doesn't think well of herself at all.
Mm-hmm.
We all want that. And people who are drinking or abusing alcohol or abusing drugs, they really want to regain their self-esteem. So what you just said about this is the Scott Kidd formula. This is the formula for regaining self-esteem. Do esteemable actions just out of, you know, wanting to, like just wanting to, and then others will say, no, I really like that, Scott. You know, like that was really a nice thing you did, Scott. And, you know, God, we really like, you know, we really enjoy this. And they go, and you get the, you know, you were just doing it because you thought it was the right thing. And all of a sudden, this feedback, the social positive reinforcement from family, from loved ones, from individuals you just met for the first time, it says to you, you're a good guy, and you know that was an esteemable thing.
Yeah, well, that's
like,
it, right?
Shit. And he's like, boom! Yeah, it's so simple, you know.
Yeah, maybe if I'm aware and in relation to whatever reality context I'm in, whatever that looks like, whatever environment I'm in, if I'm aware of what's going on in relation to other people and stuff, you know, if I'm capable and needed to be helpful today in an earnest, altruistic fashion, then that would be the right thing for me to do, would to be useful and to be helpful. Because the antithesis to that in active addiction is really not, is quite the opposite of that, right? It's very self-absorbed help, right? I'm helping only myself at the expense of others.
Which is like the equation is in terms of pleasure, potential pleasure and potential benefit, like even to self is like 1/10 maybe, or possibly 1/1,000,000 of, or in technical aspects,
sure,
just people 1 in 8 billion.
So am I going to contribute is what I'm saying today,
yeah,
positively, or am I going to take negatively? Because he can't take enough when you're in active addiction.
That's one of the things I try to educate.
It's a fucking black. It's a fucking black hole of take.
Yeah.
It's a black hole of take, and everything goes in the black hole.
Yeah.
And that's really no wonder we end up with low self-esteem, because why would any human being really? And that's the critical point. No human being chooses to do that. That's not a choice.
That's brilliant.
Fucking not a choice.
Yeah.
And if anything, one of the benefits of recovery is learning about these things and being able to see that and to see that the person is still there and it's not to be conflated with behavior. But before I go down that road, like, see the person, not the behavior.
Yeah.
Somewhere before the behavior is an innocent, lovable person who has just got a horrible fucking disease. And one of the symptoms of the disease is black hole consumption. That's all. Right? So today I'm not black holing consumption like I used to. It's just different, right? I still drink a shit ton of coffee, and I still am I'm still prone to like using people to get my agenda fulfilled, but it's done in a way which I believe is actually earnest and altruistic today. It's not, has, you know, there's a lot of, what I'm saying is there's a lot of curiosity and asking and requesting and good things in those behaviors today, not just like expecting, taking, being, feel like I'm owed that because I'm a victim. You know, fill my needs. I'm more inclined to look at your needs today, right? In healthy relationship where I'm showing up 100% in my 50%, that's all I can do today. And I choose to do that. So I'll show up 100% in my 50% of any relationship today, including this one, with the understanding that it's not going to be perfect. And that's okay. Because it's not black and white, perfect and not today. You know, that judgment is gone. Taking myself personally, and you know, and over, you know, being overly sensitive, you know, I don't take myself so seriously anymore. Rule 62, right? And that's just what it is. And before I forget, like, it's not my way, the self-esteem bullshit, which is not bullshit, but the self-esteem bullshit I was sort of talking about, like, this has been known for a long time. Bill W. Yeah. Literally said, you cannot think your way into right action.
Yeah.
You have to act your way into right thinking.
Yeah. It was brilliant play of words, and it's so memorable. It's absolute simplicity and genius.
Which is the golden rule.
Yes,
the
it is.
Rule.
Yeah, which was what? 5,000 years ago, and Gautama Siddhartha, or 3,500 years ago, and then before him.
Sure. Oh, 10 my commandments, God. 8 yeah.
No, how far do you want to go back?
Yeah, how far?
Yeah. And it's been reiterated in ways that you and I can relate to, which was the brilliance of Bill W. He was able to go, today, this is what people understand today, right? And
which is why the big book is called A Design for Living, because I don't have a drug problem or a drinking problem. I've got a living problem.
Yeah.
And I need a design for how to live with the understanding that I've got a brain disease. Mm-hmm. So how am I going to live with that brain disease and not succumb to the symptom, which is drinking, drugging, using, consuming, right? Well, it's laid out.
Yeah, it's funny. I have to share a story with you, which you're going to enjoy, because, you know, I am not a 12 stepper. I didn't go through the 12 steps to achieve, you know, recovery. And yet,
Hold on. I'm going to challenge you on that right away. Yeah,
but go ahead. Okay. So go ahead. Challenge
me. Interrupt this right now.
Sure.
Because you probably adopted principles and values in your life, which were inherent in the actual design for living that the 12-step program actually suggests in your life. And I do that all the time, because not everybody likes to hear a 12-stepper or big book thumper, right? So I don't. But I will talk to you in principles and ideas and value systems and belief systems that are all inherent in 12-step facilitation, and not mention the big book at all.
Okay, so fessing up, while not having gone to a meeting for myself, I have attend. I have attended meetings. You know, basically open meetings. Absolutely.
Sure. Yeah.
While not having a official sponsor myself, I have done all of the 12 steps very thoroughly, and continue to do them in a let's call it a secular fashion.
Sure.
So that, you know, absolutely busted on that, and happily to say so, because some of my best friends are ardent 12-stepping thumpers. Okay, they're 12. They thump on. They just like pound the 12 step, and it's like, and they're some of my best friends. And I go, oh, yeah, that's interesting, Anthony. You know, so, and I have a little story to share with you, which is very funny, I think. So, I have a working associate, and became a friend. First name's named Joe, and he has a rehab, really good rehab in Southern California. And he named it something, and he told me once, but I never really got the name ingrained, or I never saw the epiphany. Really never came to mind in the way it just came to mind at about 2 minutes ago when you said it. The 12th step is a design for living. Guess what the name of his center is? Design for living. Design for living. And it was like, oh, and he told me at the time, and I went, oh. Now, this was before a lot of experience occurred. This was 15 years, more than 16, 17 years ago, you know, and great program. And obviously based on the 12-step program. It's not just based on, he does the 12-step program. That is the program. And he's got a lot of holistic actions that he does that is congruent and assists the whole process of releasing that inner child, you know, music therapy, dance therapy, singing. And it's a fabulous program. People love it. They have a lot of fun. And the 12th step is done. It is a 12-step program called Design for Living. And he's got some beautiful freaking homes down in Southern California. When I say beautiful, I mean, you go, you sure this is a halfway house? You sure this is a sober house? Because you go, this ain't no sober house that I'm, I mean, it's like a frat, you know, that's the definition of a sober house is a frat house, right? This is, If I could live there, I would, because it's like it would be a huge jump up from where I'm living. I mean, they're gorgeous.
Yeah. You know?
But anyway, go ahead.
I was just like thinking that's pretty interesting that sounds like the beautiful environment that these people get a chance to be in to do their work is you know, there's people investing in other people. That's all I'm saying, which is a beautiful thing, right? And that's just it, right? Like, that's the essence of it, you know, like that's the essence of the idea, really, I think, behind the ideology. And it's just one ideology, you know, Alcoholics Anonymous is just one ideology. We already sort of leaned in on, well, we talked about the Buddhist tradition, we talked about the Christian tradition, you could probably go and look at Jewish, the Quran, and you can go look at all these other ideologies that are secular or religious in nature, and you will find probably that principles are all basically the same about like how to be a good person and live with other people on this globe while we're hurtling around in space at 178,000 kilometers an hour together. While we're still alive.
Yes. I mean, how is that even possible?
The only thing that's screwing that up is people's black and white thinking about the readings that they're doing.
Yeah.
And then attaching some sort of significant meaning that their belief system has translated and transcribed into some sort of weird action, which looks like war and, you know, persecution and atrocity and you know, the need for power, prestige, and property, right? So whatever, right? All I'm saying, man, is that if I was to say that it's just about being a good person that's helpful, right? Mm-hmm. That's all it is. Mm-hmm. Then that would be a completely different thing, right? Than the arcane language that's, you know, purported in the big book, right? Which is so hard for people to get over. When in fact, in chapter two, there's a massive disclaimer anyway, or for agnostics, who where it says you don't have to like subscribe to my kind of God. You can choose whatever fucking God you want. But nobody seems to like be able to like remember that who's a, you know, 12 steppers as being religious. Because you know why? Because they're never long enough to get a sponsor to take them through the big book and to look at that thing in We Agnostics. They just go to a meeting and hear God and they leave. Well, what does that look like? It looks exactly like the closed-mindedness that Richard Rohr talks about in Black and White Thinking, which is our true addiction. And I firmly believe that to be what our addiction is. So if I have a living problem, means I got this brain disease, then maybe isn't that a lot easier to reduce stigma all around? Like, for example, if I go, you know, oh, he's a junkie. No, he's not a junkie. He's a human being.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
He's an indigenous junkie. Even like more stigmatizing and marginalizing. Oh, she's a single mom with three kids, indigenous and a junkie. Can we keep going down the road? Because everybody focuses not on the person and what they're going through. They focus on what the ultimate thing is. They look at that junkie piece and they make a value judgment around how she is. So they don't realize that it's just a symptom.
Yeah.
It's just a symptom of the brain disease.
Yeah.
And so that's why the harm reductionists are like all over, like, you know, looking at the problem and staying in the problem instead of the solution, which is what happens after we stop drinking and drugging, because my addiction and my brain disease starts after I stop.
Isn't that funny? I mean, it's not funny, but it's like, it's startlingly awakening, right? Recovery.
My
happens.
Relapses then are not about like the drinking, the drinking and drugging relapses. They're about attitudinal and brain relapses and the way I think.
Yeah.
So I've got a living and thinking disease,
which is resolved in recovery, and that's why recovery is
not
ongoing.
You know,
I see your point, and I accept your point in that it's an ongoing process. And when I say resolved, I mean specifically it is, let's call it, remedied by active recovery, right?
Yeah.
It's if there's a remedy to it, it's like, oh yeah, if, for example, I solved my need for oxygen today. Really? Really?
Yeah. Right,
like,
no,
I'm resolving it every, well, some people every 2 seconds. I slow breathe. So I'm like probably 5, 10, 15 seconds. Sometimes I'll do a full breath cycle and I try to get slower than that. Right. So that's my thing. I'm a swimmer. So breathing is important. Runner, breathing is important. Sure. Scott, this has been an awesome conversation around recovery. Man, I had some big takeaways on it. You know, the black and white thinking, brilliant. We might have a few seconds to just, you know, a final couple of words, but it's going to be brief. Go ahead.
Well, yeah, I just know that, you know, one of the phrases in 12 step is it works if you work it, right? Well, here's the thing. They call it work for a reason. Because it is work, it's hard, but it's worth it if you work it, because the results are great. And for me, I got to remember that.
Yeah.
It's continuous work on myself that gets results.